morning, hello, and welcome to a very special Chai and Why Up Close with Science. So for many of you who might be watching this for the first time, Chai and Why happens on the first, third, and fifth Sundays of every month, if there is a fifth Sunday in the month. And someone from TIFR is there, usually in a public domain. We are typically at Prithvi Theatre on the first Sundays, at Rupa College on the first Sundays, Alexandra School on the fifth Sunday. But now, of course, thanks to the lockdown, we are doing it mostly from here, which is great because we can actually do it from our labs and give you a flavor of what we do. In fact, this third Sunday Chai and Why is a very unusual one for me. This is after probably 8 years, the January 3rd Sunday Chai and Why is the one I'll be curating, because normally I'm running the Mumbai Marathon on the third Sunday of January, but this year it's cancelled. But that's good for you, because we've been able to bring you Up Close with Science, which is going to be live watching the science that we do over here. So first thing, of course, we'd like to know, you know, we don't know who's watching, which is very difficult. In a way, it's good to do it online because you see the lab is very small. We couldn't fit probably more than 10 or 15 people in the lab if we had visitors. But this way, online, hopefully many of you will be able to join us as we operate the electron microscopes. Before I introduce Bhagyashree, who's going to do all the hard work for today, I thought maybe it's a good idea to take stock of, you know, who's watching. Where are you watching from, and what's your background? So for those on the Zoom webinar, I think I'd request our moderators to put on the first poll for the Zoom webinar. Please do tell us where are you watching from. So we'll keep the poll live for a minute or so. You know, just click and tell us where you're watching from. If you're watching this on YouTube or Facebook, just type in through your comments, where are you watching from? Are you in India, in Europe, are you in the US? Because I know that this thing has been spread in some networks across many places. So it would be nice to get a feel for where you are watching from. Of course, the poll doesn't show up on the YouTube, I guess. It will show up only for those who are on the webinar. But do click and tell us, or write in your comments and tell us where are you watching from. Yes, I know it's probably late if you're watching it from the US. Late Saturday night for you, Sunday morning over here. We've never done this across the world like this. It's a new experience. We must thank the SIP program at UC Santa Cruz, who also publicized this in their networks. And yeah, the other question we'd like to ask you is, let's go to the second question. The second question is, you know, we don't know who you are. Are you school students? Are you college students? Are you just public? You know, we just would like to know the level at which we should pitch it, depending on most of our people who are watching. So do tell us what kind of a background you have. Again, you can enter it as comments in the chat, in YouTube or Facebook, or you know, if it's the webinar you're on, you can always click the poll. Okay, so yeah. You know, we always want to watch things up close. Okay, moderators, are we done with the poll? Can we get back to the session? Have you got the second poll also done? So just where at what level they are? Okay, I guess it's done. So let me move ahead. You know, we've always been talking about, you know, trying to look at things closely. And the easiest way to look at things closely is, of course, with a magnifying glass, right? You can probably see my eye magnified, the magnifying glass. But a magnifying glass is only that much useful. You can see some things, maybe you can burn some, you know, in the sun, you can burn some paper or something like that. But people very soon, many hundred years ago, decided that if they combine lenses, they could do much better, and they made things like a microscope. Here's a very, very small microscope. This is a tiny microscope. It's actually a microscope used for, you know, when we prepare samples for electron microscopy itself. It's an optical microscope. This has many lenses. It has a few lenses here, a couple of lenses in the eyepiece. You can sort of increase the magnitude. But still, there's a limit to what you can see with an optical microscope. You need to do somehow better than that. And that's where electron microscopy comes in. This is an electron microscope. But before we get there, let me introduce the one of the most experienced electron microscopists in India, Bhagyashree Chalke. Bhagyashree has been at TIFR for how many years?
27 years.
27 yeah. years. She has a lot of experience in microscopy. 27 years at TIFR. She is the most experienced electron microscopist that we have here. And over to you, basically. Where do we start? Maybe we should start by just telling people about how small are we going to see?
Yeah.
So I guess you've seen this. This is a ruler, which is 30 centimeters. If you're in the US, it's 1 foot, I guess. And it's divided into little lines, millimeters, inches, whatever. But typically what we are used to, the smallest divisions we usually see are centimeters and millimeters. Okay. And maybe we should go then to the level of different objects that we have in the world. And of course, if you have something at the size of a centimeter, let's say an ant. Okay. And a very small bug might be about a millimeter. Millimeter, and if you go 10 times, so we're going to keep going 10 times smaller. If you go 10 times smaller than a millimeter, it's a, what we would call 100 micrometers or 0.1 millimeter. And that's about the width of a hair. And this is stuff you can see in an optical. This is about the limit. You know, the width of a hair is what you can't really see details on a hair. If you had an optical microscope, you could go down in a little bit more detail. You could see red blood cells. You could probably see bacteria and things like that. Beyond that, when you want to go really smaller, you need to go down to using electrons. And at this point, I'm going to let Bhagyashree take over and tell us about all of this. So why isn't light good enough? Why do we need electrons?
See, in light microscope, the image is formed either by the light which is transmitted through the sample or the light which is reflected from the sample. And in electron microscope, the image is formed by the electrons which are emitted from the samples. So here, the difference is the wavelength. The wavelength of electron is much, much smaller, almost 100,000 smaller than the light microscope. That's why we use electron microscope to see the objects which are in the range of nanometer to picometer level. So shall we start seeing some samples? Yeah. Let's start with sample loading, okay? So these are the stubs on which we stick. These are the stubs on which we stick our samples with carbon tape. Okay, now.
But what are the samples you have today? I mean, what are we going to see today?
Oh yeah, we have some interesting samples. So here, this is a hair. Okay, we'll be seeing it in microscope, electron microscope. These are the eyes of the fruit fly.
Oh, that is a fly? That's the fly, the
this,
big brown one.
This
yeah,
is
that's
the fly. Yeah, okay. This is the fly.
Okay.
And these are the eyes of the fruit fly. Okay. This is a rose petal.
Wow.
We will see the details in the electron microscope. Details on the surface of the petal. These are the nanowires.
So those are the real science samples.
Yeah,
right?
This is the real science samples.
I wonder where you got them from.
Oh, these are grown in your lab. Yeah. Okay. So these are the nanowires. Okay. So these samples, they are already loaded in the electron microscope. So I will show you how the samples are loaded.
Okay. So we actually have two electron microscopes over here. And since it takes some time after you load the samples, the column needs to be, the air has to be removed from it, evacuated, etc. It takes some time. So we've already loaded some samples early in the morning when we came in. But just to show you how it works, we have a second microscope and we're just going to load a dummy sample in that so you can see what is happening. So this is, of course, the instrument is the microscope, and you can see there's a little camera screen as well. This shows you this is a sort of a video camera that's inside where you can see the samples. But now we're going to open up the microscope and put the things in.
See, remember, for electron microscope, the sample should be dried thoroughly because the samples are going to go in the high vacuum. So we cannot load wet samples or moist samples in electron microscopes. So the samples should be dry completely. There are different samples for imaging wet samples. We can actually image the water droplets also in the electron microscope. This one is used for wet sample imaging or biological sample imaging. But whatever the microscope which we'll be showing you today, that's meant for the dry samples, which is a high resolution SEM. So I will show you how the samples are loaded in the SEM. Since it was under high vacuum, we have vented the chamber now.
So you're allowing air to come inside
yes.
the chamber so that the pressure can be the same and then you will open it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the venting is the easy part. Pumping it down takes longer, which is why we actually decided to load the samples beforehand. Yeah, so that's the place inside where the samples will be mounted.
Yeah.
So there is a little rotating holder on which you can put multiple samples. So these samples are these little discs that go into their slots. They are called little stubs. And once you load a sample, you put it in there, and typically you put a little number on it so you can identify which one it is. And you can also see these, there's a camera inside and you can see the same, we'll see the same, these are exactly the same samples that you saw on the stage over there. And we will put some samples in and then shut it.
Okay, now I will pump the chamber. And we will have to wait till the vacuum reaches to somewhere around 10 to the power minus 5, minus 6 millibars. So that's why we have already loaded the samples in a microscope, which we'll be showing it to you. But just before going to the microscope, it is always better to have some little idea about how electron microscope works. So this is the schematic or cross-section of a scanning electron microscope. So this is electron gun, which is a source of electron, okay? When it is heated, the electron beam comes out of it. I have got the electron gun for you. So this is the filament. It is a wire, tungsten wire, a very similar to what we have. A very similar to what we have in our bulbs and all. Okay, so this is the filament. The electron beam is formed here. Okay, and you remember, we need a very focused electron beam. That's why the focusing is done by the The focusing is done by the lenses. These are electromagnetic lenses. In light also, we use lenses, which are glass lenses, to focus the beam. So the beam is focused by the apertures and the lenses, and then this beam falls on the sample. When this primary electron beam interacts with the sample atoms, different signals are emitted from the samples. And they are very, very useful. They carry very useful information about the samples. So when this electron beam hits the sample, the secondary electrons are emitted from the samples. And they are emitted from the surface of the sample. So they carry the information about the topography of the sample. Then we get very interesting information from the characteristics X-rays also. Now, how these X-rays are formed? When this primary beam hits the sample atom, it knocks out the inner shell electron, and then the outer shell electron jumps in, and in this process, the X-rays are emitted from the sample. And these X-rays, they are called characteristics X-rays. For example, if you have a copper in your sample, the copper K alpha X-ray is at energy of 8.04 keV. So I can identify which element is present in my sample. If I measure the energy of these X-rays properly, I can also do a compositional analysis of the sample. If in the system there is a database where I know if I hit the sample with a 5 kV electron beam.
You know what? I think this was not supposed to be a lecture. I think we should get to seeing things. That might be more exciting. You can, you know, explain it why we have seen.
I know, Anna, but just give me a time. Okay. No. Yeah, I will just explain how the image is formed. Basically, every sample is have some topography at the nanometer scale. So the secondary electrons which are emitted from the Healy region, the more number of secondary electrons reach the detector, and the crest-like region, the less number of electrons reach. That is how we form the grayscale on the sample. And there are scanning sample. We scanning coils in the SEM. Remember, we need to scan the whole sample, and that is how the sample, the image is formed. Okay, we move the electron beam over the sample, and the point-to-point information is put up on the screen. So let's go back to the microscope. So here in this microscope, this is the filament. Here is a filament. Okay, this is the sample chamber where we load our samples. This is the EDS detector, which measures the energy of the X-rays which are coming out from the sample. And this one is the detector which is used for imaging. This one is the detector which is used for imaging. So second electron detector. So this is the console.
You have something like a PlayStation.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, you also have joysticks.
Yes. So it's a microscope. So it should have a magnification knob. Okay. It should have a focus knob. We need to move the stage. So it will have X, Y, and Z movement for the stage. Okay. Now let's go back to the microscope.
Okay, so now I think we will just keep the camera focused on the screen where we will see things, and then we will look at the samples one by one. By the way, we are doing this entirely using basically two mobile phones. No fancy cameras, etc. We're just using two mobile phones for this. I hope we can do that. Just bear with us till we get this thing on a little. Yep, we balanced it so that it views the screen. I think that's probably good enough. And Shilpa, I'm actually going to, I'm going to leave the room so that you can actually remove your mask and speak loud enough and be captured. Well. Okay, I think that's good. You can tell them what they're supposed to look at, etc. And I will.
So as I mentioned earlier, we have loaded human hair, a rose petal, fruit fly eye, and a nanowire sample in the microscope. So first I will switch on the EHT. So any guess, what is this? Okay, magnifying the image. So this one is the head of the fruit fly, the flies which we generally see on bananas and all. I'm moving the stage, coming closer to the lenses. So this is how the head of the fruit fly looks. The fruit fly has compound eyes. This is an eye of a fruit fly. And this is divided into some 760 parts. So we can see each part.
Wow. Those are the individual eyes?
Yeah.
And what are those stick-like things coming out? There's some stick-like things coming out.
Yeah, they are the bristles. They are sensory organs of the flies. And when these researchers, they do experiments, the length of these bristles changes. Sometimes they vanish from the eye. And then they come back to electron microscope to see the changes. So this is how an eye of a fruit fly looks in electron microscope. So if you want to measure the length of the bristle, it is in microns. This is 15 microns.
Is it possible for you to put the magnification on screen?
Yeah, I will do that. And it is about 2 micron wide. So now this image is at 62K. X roughly 62,000 magnification is 62,000 in this image. Okay, so this was an eye of a fruit fly.
Okay, maybe this is a good time to do a question for the audience. You know, the fruit fly is an amazing organism if you ask a biologist. You know, many Nobel Prizes in medicine and physiology have gone on to researchers who worked on the fruit fly. So here's a question for you. How many Nobel Prizes has this humble little fruit fly contributed in? You think it's 2, 4, 6, 8, 10? How many Nobel Prizes? The fruit fly deserves, you know, a huge round of applause from all of us, simply because it has enabled some amazing research in biology. Isn't that beautiful? I mean, that eye of the fly, I can look at this. Okay, so let's see. Shall we go on to another question? I mean, other sample. Can you put the magnification on screen? Okay, what is this 7,000 magnification? What is the magnification? That's a question that's coming.
So the magnification is 7,000 here. You can see the magnification. Basically, if you look at this marker bar, this much is 20 micron.
One second, the video's gone off. Okay.
So you can see the magnification. This one is at 7,000 magnification now. And here, this is the marker bar. This is the marker bar. So this much is 20 micron. So from that, you can make out the sizes of the different objects on the screen.
Okay. Let's move to something else now.
So all of us have seen rose petal. Let's see how it looks in the electron microscope. So this rose petal, it has some interesting structures. We can see these cluster-like things on the rose petal. So there are some nanostructures on these rose petal. If I do a low mag, you can see some clustered nanowires kind of thing here.
So there are clusters of these very tiny little ups and downs. And is that why a water drop doesn't stick to a rose petal?
Yeah, that is the reason why we call that the rose petals are hydrophobic, because the water drop doesn't stick here. Now, can we make similar samples in the lab? Yes, we have made some samples in the lab which are very similar to rose petal. I will show you those samples now. These are the copper nanowires, and they have the structure similar to rose petals. So they also have cluster, and this cluster is made up of copper nanowires, and these are synthesized in the lab. Okay, so these are clustered copper nanowires. Now, since they are clustered copper nanowires, they should be hydrophobic. And then we have imaged the water droplets on these copper nanowires on a environmental SEM. So I will show you the image of the water droplets. Here I can't show it live because this is a high vacuum SEM. So these are the copper droplets formed on this copper nanowire clustered. And we can see that a very small water droplet, which is of the order of 1 micron or 2 micron, that is also staying as it is. I mean, it's not dripping through.
Okay, while we put the camera back, a couple of questions have come in. So why is the image black and white?
See, as I mentioned earlier, in SEM, the image is formed by the secondary electrons which are emitted from the sample. And every sample will have some kind of topography. So from the Healy region, the secondary electrons which are coming from the Healy region, they will reach the detector, they will be more in the number. And from the depth, they will be less in the number. So that is how the grayscale in the image is formed. That is why the SEM images are always black and white. And if you see any color image which people claim that is SEM, that image, that's a false colored, or that's colored afterwards.
Okay, there's one more question. Can you explain these things which are seen in the line below the thing? There is a green line which says 10. There is something which says EHD and WD. And could you just explain what is this?
So I'll start with this. This is the marker bar. Is that steady?
Yeah, I think that's steady now.
So this is the marker bar. This means that this line is 10 micron on the screen. So if you want to measure, let's see the cluster size roughly. So this is about 1.7 micron, okay? And this much length is 10 micron. So this is a marker bar. This is the acceleration voltage. Now I'm operating the microscope at 5 kV. This microscope can go up to 30 kV. And we choose the energies depending on the application. This is the working distance. Basically, it is the distance between the final objective lens and the sample. You can call it, Okay, basically it is the distance between the final objective lens and the sample, and it will change, the focus will change if I move the sample, like if I get it very close. Maybe you can get it here, you can see that WD value changing. So we can see this WD value changing. That means this is the.
So you're moving up and down.
Up
the lens
and down.
Is, the sample
yeah.
is coming closer to the lens.
The sample is coming
closer
to the
lens.
Okay. And then.
Put the screen properly. I just kept it very.
This is the detector which I'm using for imaging. So right now I'm using SE2 detector, secondary electron detector. For imaging, there are different detectors. We can have in-lens detector. This also is used for imaging, but there are different purposes of these detectors. Then there are this backscattered imaging, which can give you a compositional image depending on the Z contrast in the sample. See, in case of SEM, the contrast coming from the image also depends on the atomic number of the sample. So if you have gold, it will look more brighter. If you have carbon in your sample, it will look darker. So that is how this AHB detector, it forms the image, which we call a compositional image. So can we move to the next sample? Or?
Yes, please.
So I'm moving to the next sample. I said we have kept a human hair. So you can see an image of the hair on the screen right now. Let's check the diameter of the hair. Okay, so this is about 58 micron. You can read this value. This is 58 micron. So this is the diameter. And when I magnify this, you start seeing the scales in the hair. It's a growth pattern. And this we don't see with normal eyes.
Are these the things that break off and give me dandruff?
Yeah. You know, in shampoo ads, they show that your hair will become smoother if they use if you use their shampoo. But then how do they carry out their research on hair? Maybe they are using electron microscope.
So this hair is with shampoo or without shampoo?
Oh, this is without shampoo, a dry hair, I would call it. Okay. So we have shown you hair just to mark the diameter. Okay, so this is about 53 micron. Now we will move to the objects which are much, much smaller than this.
So now in comparison to the hair, you're going to show us the real samples that we usually work on.
Yeah.
Okay, so clearly, you know, I don't think the electron microscope at TFR is used to look at rose petals and, you know, hair, etc. We do put it in because it gives you an idea of the size. But let's see a real sample from the world of science. This is a sample of what I call semiconductor nanowires. So semiconductors are materials that are used for example in all circuits to make electronic components in your mobile phone, etc. And people want to make them smaller and smaller every year, And one way of making them small is to make them into very, very tiny wires. And this, which looks like grass, is very similar, but it's a million times smaller. I mean, you can see that right now the scale bar is about 10 microns. Remember that your hair is about, well, 50 microns, 100 microns. So it's about, you know, a factor 10 bigger. You know, the hair would fill up the whole screen on this magnification. So now we're looking at things which are way, way smaller than that. And we can probably zoom into this. Let's see, we can zoom into this.
So the scale bar which you see on this microscope right now is approximately 50 microns. So this is the width of a hair.
The hair you saw was about the same width as that green line on the screen.
Yeah.
Okay, let's keep zooming in maybe. Should have some interesting shapes. So now we are at a magnification of almost 200,000.
So let's check.
Now you can see the green bar on the bottom is only 200 nanometers. So it's 0.2 microns is that green bar. You're at a magnification of about 500,000. This is about, you know, as much as we will be able to get clear pictures at. And you can see these little filaments of semiconductor materials. And you can see, even compared to the 200 nanometer marker, they are much thinner. Some of the wires are really, really thin, probably less than 50 nanometers in thickness. How do you know what material this is?
We'll see the tip of the wire or?
We'll see the tip. Okay. Yeah, of course. So when we grow these wires, when we actually make these wires in the laboratory, we actually start growing these wires with a little metal particle, with a little gold particle. So many of them are probably broken off in this part, but maybe if we hunt somewhere else, we will find wires which have a metal particle at the tip. We might have to hunt for one. There. Okay, that's gone off. Okay, now this is really, you can see we are pushing the magnification so high, you can barely make out. Look at the clarity of this image, right? This image is not as clear, but now you're at 3.8 million times magnification. Right? It's about 20 nanometers is the marker. The width of the wire is slightly more than 20 nanometers at the tip. But I don't know if you can, maybe we can zoom out a bit. Yeah, you can see that the tip is probably a tiny bit darker than the rest of the wire.
No, actually, it's speaking vibration because we are speaking.
Yeah, this is the electron microscope is so sensitive. The fact that we are speaking, that itself causes vibrations, which will make it not so steady. In fact, we are in the basement. That's because that's the place where the building is the most stable. If you were anywhere else, there would be vibrations from the building as well. Okay, we are scanning this slowly. And hopefully you will see that there is a little tip. Okay. And the wire is about 35 nanometers here in diameter. Okay. How do you, Manishi, going back to our earlier question, how do you know what the material is? Are these like the same silicon materials which are used in circuits and...
Well, these guys are from your lab. You should know what is the material there.
Yeah, but I
want me to find out.
Get confused. What if we mixed up some samples? Can we find out what material it is?
Yeah, sure. So I have to change some parameters.
So the way you can look at elements in the electron microscope is by basically using these electrons which are coming in, the electrons that you're accelerating, the electrons that we're using to image, these will also knock out the electrons from the atoms of the sample. And if an electron gets knocked out, that place is not going to stay vacant for a long time. Other electrons in the atom will jump in and fill it up. And when these electrons jump between energy levels of an atom, you will see characteristic X-rays that are emitted. So if you look at the X-rays that are emitted when these electrons are hitting the sample, we can figure out what elements there are. So we're going to now move to another screen where we are looking at the signal from the X-ray detector. We're looking at the signal from the X-ray detector here. So what you see, okay, we are starting to count the signals. On the X-axis is energy. This in kilo electron volts, that's the energy of the X-ray. And the Y-axis, these yellow colored pillars are effectively the how many such X-rays are being detected per unit time at different energies. So you can see there are some very strong peaks. There is here, there is indium, there is arsenic, there is silicon. Of course, there is also, there will always be some little bit of carbon and oxygen. These are just some impurities around. But we thought these wires were indium and arsenide, and that's what it is. You can see the elemental composition. It shows that these wires are actually mostly composed of indium and arsenic. So so we can actually look at the elements and actually figure out what the composition of the wire is. We can do composition analysis in an electron microscope like this. Okay, so that's the picture of the nanowires. But you know, I thought you said that we would be able to see you would be able to see atoms, right?
Yes.
But I didn't see any atoms.
No, because this microscope will not show you any atoms. The resolution of this microscope is one nanometer. And if you look at the interatomic distances, they are of the order of picometers. So we have to go to some other microscope. This one, SEM, is only meant for surface imaging surface features from the sample. So we have other microscopes, which are known as transmission electron microscope. There, yes, we can see atoms.
Okay, so now it's time to visit another lab where
What is this big frame which is not there on the other microscope?
Oh,
this is this big frame with some wires and that's not there on that microscope. What is it?
Yes, see, the electron microscopy labs have to be prepared very carefully because we are imaging something at nanometer level. Okay, so that's why the labs are in the basement to get rid of the floor vibrations. And here also the electromagnetic noise, which is a nuisance for the imaging. And this is the EMI cancellation, electromagnetic interference cancellation system, which have put. So there are coils around the SEM column. And this is the control for that. Now on the screen, you can see the field is about 19 nanotesla. So when I cancel this, in short, if I switch off this, it goes to 700 nanotesla. And this will result in vibrating of image, or we can see the jagged edges in the image. So that's why we have put this noise cancellation setup.
Are focused using magnetic fields.
Yes.
And there is the Earth's magnetic field. There is magnetic field due to all the electrical wires in the room.
Yes.
So
yes.
You want to minimize electrical field.
Yes.
So these coils sort of cancel out the electrical field by generating their own electrical fields.
This is an active cancellation system.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So can we move to the next lab?
So now I think it's time to go to the next lab.
Yeah, so maybe people want to see atoms now.
Let's
so
go to the next lab. So we will now move to another lab where there is a transmission electron microscope. And let's see what we can see there. We can probably take one of these samples and go. So now we're going to go to another room where there is another microscope. These are all different deposition systems. This is not related to the electron microscope. But now we have gone into a room which has a transmission electron microscope. And the over the headset, and also introduce Rudhir. Rudhir Bapat is
Hi.
Another professional electron microscopist at the IFR. He's also been here for very long.
Yeah, about 20 years.
About 20 years. So he's got a lot of experience. And wow, you've got a very fancy microscope here. This seems pretty big, right?
Yeah.
I mean, this microscope is, compared to the SEM, this is a very big microscope.
Yes, it is.
I'm going to hide in the corner there. That way,
yeah. Yeah, so as you said, it really is a big microscope. The reason for that is, unlike the SEM, in this microscope, we look at the image which is formed by the electrons which pass through the sample. So the sample is loaded somewhere here. So the top portion is maybe something like the SEM that you saw. But then below that, there are some lenses, as well as there is a viewing chamber in which we view the image that is formed. Because this is the sample, the electrons pass through the sample and we see the image here. And there is a CCD camera below. So when we want to record the images, we can just lift this screen. And then the image is grabbed on the CCD camera, which is placed below. So as I said, that in this, the electrons need to pass through the sample so that they can be imaged. So for this, the prime requirement is that the samples have to be very thin. So the typically TEM sample is around 30 to 40 nanometers in thickness. So preparing a sample itself is not a very easy process. So there are various processes for different types of samples, like bulk samples and powder samples, thin film samples, etc. So the easiest one is the powder samples. So what is done is the powder samples are first put in a solvent, then they're sonicated, and then a drop is put on these copper grids. You can see this grid, this disc. So this disc has a mesh of copper, and on that there is a carbon film, a thin carbon film. So when we put a drop of the powder on this, the powder sits on the carbon grid. Now these grids are then lifted and mounted in this sample holder. So this is the sample holder for the TEM. So here the grids are mounted in this. So after mounting this, the sample holder is then removed and then it is put inside. So right now, because this is a long process involved, we will not be showing you live images that we will be taking, but I have stored some images and I will be showing you them on this console.
So this microscope basically can go to a higher magnification or a better resolution?
Yes, this can go to a much better resolution as compared to the SEM. In this, you can actually see the atoms in the atomic columns of the sample. So if you see this image, in this image, this is the image of the nanowires, which you have already seen in the SEM. This is one of the nanowires. You can see it also has a tip on that. And if you see in this region, there's some dark and white contrast. So this is a low magnification image for this microscope.
But low magnification meaning, what is the scale bar?
So you can see the scale bar. It is 100 nanometers.
Okay, so this is what you call low magnification for this microscope.
Yes, this is low magnification for this microscope. Now when you zoom in, I have the next image. So on zooming in, you can see this kind of a structure. You can see some dots here. So these are actually the atomic positions of the atomic columns in this nanowire. And these lines you see are the defects that are present in this nanowire. Okay. So
this material was actually grown layer by layer. And sometimes when these layers of atoms were deposited, there was some, you know, error in the alignment of the way these atoms lined up, and that shows up as a slight difference in brightness.
Yes, in the TEM
planes of atoms that you're seeing. So what you're seeing are basically atomic planes that you can see, and what some of these things, they're called, you know, stacking faults or some kind of faults, and so these dots that you see there, they show you the atomic planes.
Yeah, and the reason
a little bit more on this. Can you take some pictures?
So basically what you can see here is the atomic columns you're already seeing in this. Okay. So now, but since you are seeing atomic columns because this is a crystalline sample, right? Now,
so these basically, just remember that these white dots that you're seeing, they're not individual atoms.
Yes,
but they're atomic columns. And this is like a crystal where there is a whole network of atoms, and you're looking down.
Right. So, because
there are lots of atoms behind it as well.
Right.
So, it's not just one atom, there are lots of atoms behind it. But since these atoms are regularly arranged in a crystal, you can see the pattern over here.
Yeah.
Effectively, if I measure the separation between these two dots, that will be the interatomic spacing in this.
That will be the interatomic. Yes. And while imaging the samples, we need to tilt the samples accordingly so that the atoms fall below each other exactly. Okay. So, now, as you said, we can measure the atomic distances in this, but a better way of measuring atomic distances is to take a diffraction pattern. So this is a diffraction pattern which has been taken for the sample. So now here we can measure the dots that are there, and then you can know exactly what is the despacing between the atoms.
So this is sort of looking at the way the electrons spread out when they go through this very thin layer.
Yes, when they interact with the very thin
layer. The pattern that we get is going to depend on whether the electrons are arranged, say, in a cube or in a hexagon. Not electrons, the atoms.
The atoms,
are arranged in a hexagonal
arrangement. The different crystallographic arrangements that are there.
The crystallographic arrangements.
Yes.
So you can actually figure out the crystallographic arrangement.
Right.
Materials
right.
By looking at patterns.
Like by measuring the distances and the angles between these.
Okay.
So now this is a different sample. This is a rhenium selenide sample, in which you can see that there are no defects as such, as because this is not a grown sample or like a wire. So, but this has got a hexagonal symmetry. So how do you know this? So we have taken a diffraction pattern. From here you can see that this is a hexagonal pattern. So that means it has a hexagonal symmetry in this. So this is how we come to know that it is a nicely crystalline sample with a hexagonal pattern.
But you said this was rhenium selenide.
Yes.
So you can actually look at the composition also inside it, or is
yes. So just like the SEM, you can also do a EDS analysis of this to confirm that it is a rhenium selenide material. So just to demonstrate, we have here on this screen. So this is a different material. This is actually a core shell structure. So this is a cross section of a nanotube, in which you can see that this is a core shell of bismuth and cobalt. Okay, so if you see this region, okay, so these are the EDS line scan pattern. So what we have done is we have scanned the electron beam from this end to this end, and while scanning we have taken the EDS analysis. And if you can see, while I am moving the cursor, so initially you can see this graph, the green is bismuth and white is cobalt. So as I move the cursor from the edge of the tube towards the center, you can see that the cobalt counts are increasing. And then when I go further, again the bismuth counts are increasing. So this confirms that this is a tube which is made of bismuth, and cobalt which we have put in has gone inside the tube.
And how big is this tube? What is the size?
So the size of this tube is around 20 to 30 nanometers.
So you can now not only do, so there we were looking at the SEM, we were getting the analysis of a large, over a relatively large area.
Right.
Here you can look at a specific nanotube or a nanowire or a specific area for sample and look at what are the elements in the sample.
Right.
Okay. So, of course, this is a sort of normal.
Yeah, this is a microscope which everybody can.
Yes, we can of course get down to high resolution and see these atomic columns, but for very high end work, there are even more sophisticated microscopes, of which we do have one at the IFR. If you like this thing, if you enjoyed seeing these things, and you would like us to take you on a tour of that microscope, we could probably try that in future as well. Let us know in the feedback in your chat and wherever else, and we will see if we can arrange a visit to the Titan microscope someday.
Yes.
Meanwhile, I'm sure there are lots of questions. I know that we've not been able to answer them live, so maybe we should just get back and see what questions people have and take a look at some of these questions.
Sure.
Okay. So let's start making our way back. We go back to the SEM lab where Rajesh is also there. and that two of them together might be able to answer the questions over there. Okay, so let's go back. On the way, you're just passing through labs where materials are deposited and you're seeing some deposition systems. Okay, so we are now back at the SEM lab, and we have both Rudhir and Shilpa. Well, Rudhir, I think you should see in the middle because the microphone is with you.
Yeah, okay, no,
don't. Okay, for me, just give it a microphone. Yeah, give the microphone to Shilpa. The soft system on us. And okay, so now can we see what questions there are on Facebook and YouTube and the Zoom webinar? Let's see how we do this. So let's see.
On Facebook, we have one question. Can I ask
question it? On Facebook? Yes, go ahead. Devashankar, yeah. Can you tell us the question on Facebook? I will repeat it out.
So someone asked, what is the correct accelerating voltage for a good image?
Okay, so this is a very good question to both of you. How do you choose the accelerating voltage? In this case, it was you said it could go up to 30, but you were using only 5. The other one is the TEM, of course, is at 200,000 volts. This is 30,000 volts, and you were imaging at 5,000 volts. So how does one choose the acceleration voltage?
Basically, it depends on what we want to. Basically, it depends on what we want to do with the sample. Generally, for imaging purposes, we use lower KVs, like 3 KV to 5 KV. But if you want to do the compositional analysis, like if you want to study the X-rays which are coming out from the sample, then we use the higher KVs, 20 KV onwards, because the acceleration voltage has to be 3 times higher than the energy lines which we are studying. So for example, if I want to study a copper, which is present in my sample, the copper X-ray is at 8.04 KeV. So I have to use 3 times acceleration voltage to excite the copper line. So basically, it depends on the application, what we want to do with it.
As far as the TEM is concerned, so the resolution of the microscope, it depends on the acceleration voltage. So a higher acceleration voltage, the better the resolution.
Okay, so let me now take a question from the YouTube chat. Let's see. A very basic question. What is an electromagnetic lens? How do you focus an electron?
Basically, electromagnetic lens is nothing but the current carrying coils. You have the magnetic core, and then there are coils around that core. And the current through the coil basically adjusts the magnetic field around it. So that is how the electron, electromagnetic lens is prepared. And the image is focused by changing the currents through those coils.
Okay, so you're saying that a current loop is like a magnet.
Yeah.
And the magnetic field will bend the electron.
Yeah.
So we have different sort of kinds of current loops in these
columns.
The column which act as lenses.
Yeah.
And which is why also we are paranoid about external fields. We don't want any external magnetic field over there. Okay. And there is a question saying, can normal light from light bulbs interfere with this?
No.
I think it's completely sealed, right?
It is completely sealed
inside vacuum, so the room lights don't interfere with it at all. Okay, let me just go back to the Zoom webinar and see what questions we have there. I don't see the questions. Okay, I need to probably get another phone. Let's see. When you showed that hexagonal pattern, it seems there was one line which is slightly longer. Why was that? Good question.
Yeah, so that is because when we place the so the central beam is very bright and it can damage the CCD camera. So we generally block the central beam with a beam blocker. So maybe while grabbing the picture, the beam blocker was not exactly in position. That is why you could see that. Right, that is an artifact.
Is it possible to map defects in crystal patterns of atoms like silicon?
Yes.
So those different bright dark lines we saw were effectively defects that we were looking at.
They were defects.
Okay. Okay. I'm going to probably go and check out the questions on the Zoom webinar. I will come back and take a look. Meanwhile, I leave you with a question, which is here. Is a microscope just an inverted telescope?
This is electron microscope.
Yeah.
Optical microscope.
So maybe an
optical microscope
is an inverted telescope, but not a electron microscope.
So what we have shown you today is electron microscope.
The construction and the way the imaging is done is
completely different. There is one more question.
Okay, a couple of questions are asking, can you see electrons?
No.
Well, the answer probably is no.
No.
An electron really is not, remember we are using the electron, the waves of the electron to actually make these pictures, the wave properties, the fact that it behaves like a wave and gets modified when it passes through these crystalline materials. But you know, you cannot see an electron. You can see the nucleus, maybe not even at this energy, not with an electron microscope. People have done it in accelerators like, you know, the one at CERN. You can probably go up. You need huge energies if you want to see the nucleus or nuclear particles. Out here, we can only see atoms and sort of the spacings between atoms. That's what you see in an electron microscope.
So maybe because of the aberrations.
Of course, you can image viruses. Somebody is asking, can you image viruses? Yes.
Yes.
In fact, so coronavirus, for example, the people call it a corona because in an electron microscope, you can see things around the virus. Now, of course, the image is quite famous. Everybody knows it. But these things were first seen only in an electron microscope. So can you go to the subatomic realm with a microscope? The answer probably is no. Somebody asks, what is the object which is same in all samples? I don't understand the question. So if you can explain the question, we might be able to answer it better. I don't really get the question. So no, you cannot see electrons is another question. Can you see electrons moving around the atom? You cannot see that. We can only see sort of overall where the atoms are, etc. And what else is here? The EM, what does EM stand for? It's electron microscope. It's not electromagnetic, it's electron microscope. We first started off with a scanning electron microscope. That's what you use it to see the surface. The electron beam is scanning back and forth across the surface. And then we went to a transmission electron microscope where the electrons actually go through the sample. Okay. How do you see a coronavirus in a microscope? Well, you have to take the sample and to image biological samples, there are actually very special microscopes that are used. You will not put it in one of these microscopes. These microscopes that you saw today are meant for materials science research. You cannot tell somebody if somebody is COVID positive or not by looking at an electron microscope. You may be able to look at in a special microscope, but I mean there are different tests to check. I mean, remember that the electron microscope sees only a very, very, very small part. The magnification is so high, you don't see a large amount of sample. You see a very small part of the sample. Yeah, unfortunately, we are all material science people here. We know very little about viruses and absolutely nothing probably about the coronavirus, which of course is the flavor of the season. Because of it, you're all able to see this lab sitting at home. Okay. Somebody on YouTube has asked what were the colors that were some yellow and green colors. That's probably just because we are using a mobile phone to capture the screen. And there were some, you know, they're not real colors at all. Okay, I guess I can see the thing over here. This is a good way to see it. Okay, so I am back here and I'm going to look at, we've now got the Q&A and the chat over here. So I think we have, let's see. So we're not taking questions on, can you see DNA and RNA? That's the question. Yes, of course we can see DNA and RNA because they're molecules. They're pretty big molecules. We cannot see, again, I think we've looked at most of these questions. Okay, so are the white dots the atoms or are the dark dots the atoms was a question that we seem to have missed at some point in the PEM picture.
So I think that because it is a TEM image and it is a phase contrast image, so I think the dark spots will be the atom.
Okay, so I do not see any further new questions coming up.
There was a question about why you have used SC detector.
So there are different detectors. Yes, earlier there was a question on the different detectors that are used. There are. Do you want to just go ahead and tell them which are the different detectors that we use for the SEM?
Yeah, so basically there was a question like why I have used SE detector for imaging. So there are different
second electron detector.
Okay. So there are different detectors for imaging the topography of the sample. One is inlens and other is SE. Second electron, basically in the samples which I showed you today, they were biological samples and they will charge. By charge, I mean the electron beam which is falling on the sample, it will create a cloud of electrons, and if it is not grounded properly, you will not be able to see image because there are electrons on the sample already. So if we try to image through inlens detector, we can see the most the surface level features, and hence we'll be able to see the cloud of electron only. And that's why I have used secondary electron detector, which is which is used for topography imaging, and because this detector is placed in the side of the column, so we can not see the electron cloud and we can see the image.
So that is why you need actually a lot of experience before you are able to really, you know, take a sample and get a very good image in a microscope, which is why, you know, both Ruthir and Bhagyashree have got, you know, decades of experience working on this, and they know exactly which kind of detector will give them a better image for a given sample, what kind of voltage should be used, how far should the sample be kept from the lens, etc., etc. So there are lots and lots and lots of parameters that are modified, that are tweaked in order to ensure that they get the best images possible. So just before we wrap up, let me say that January is a month with January is a month with 5 Sundays. And next Sunday, we are going to answer many of the questions you asked about biological samples. We are going to look at some very fancy microscopes that are used in biology, look at some other organisms that are used in biology. That's coming up 2 weeks from now on the 31st of January. At 11 o'clock, we will again be live doing a Zoom webinar plus YouTube and Facebook. Do join us in for a glimpse into a different set of labs at the IFR. And just to also tell you that the first Sunday of February, February 7th, we're going to be back, and that's going to be a session which is a physical session at Prithvi Theatre, because we are now permitted to go back there. So, we will be there talking about something which I am sure all of you are interested in. There's a session on vaccines for COVID-19. That's happening at Prithvi Theatre on the 7th. Of course, it will be there it will be online as well. We will be both online as well. If you're in Mumbai and you'd like to visit us, we will be there at Prithvi Theatre. The thing which we cannot offer you for a session like this is chai, right? It's a lab. We're not allowed to eat and drink in a lab. I hope some of you have at least made some chai at home or coffee or whatever drink you'd like and joined us with it. We will be, and Prithvi, of course, we will have a proper chai and bai session where you can discuss things over a cup of chai, but it'll be online also. You can join us from home. Yes, I haven't answered one question somebody pointed on the poll. How many Nobel Prizes did the fruit fly contribute to? The answer so far is six. Six Nobel Prizes directly or indirectly related to research involving the fruit fly. And that's what we started with because it is such an important organism in biology. And not only that, I think it just looks so beautiful under the microscope. Okay. Our sessions are always at 11 o'clock on the first, third, and fifth Sundays of every month. You can check up Chai and Why on YouTube or Facebook. You can find out all the sessions over there. Or follow us on Twitter. We are at Chai and Why. You can get all the updates and information over there. So with this, I would really like to thank both Ruthin, who helped us show the samples on the PEM, and Bhagyashree, who showed us the samples. She's getting cut off. We just get her picture as well. So Bhagyashree, who showed us the SEM and took us through the operation of these systems, she can do the TEM as well. But we just thought that it'd be easier to have things set up over there so we don't waste time when we go from one lab to the other. I'm really thankful for Ruthin for coming in last minute and agreeing to help us out. So with that, thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this session. Do feel free to give us your feedback and see you again at another Chai and Why.
Bye-bye. Thank you so much. Bye.